Don't I'll just give you a brief introduction. We are an e-commerce company. Basically, we are into ticketing. You can buy tickets for movies, plays, sports, anything that you name in India. Okay, so today what I'll be talking about is how we rebuild the entire app which you already have right now. We have rebuilt it from scratch. We will talk about what went in, why did we decide to do all of those things, and give you a brief idea as to what is happening. So this is the short agenda as to give you an idea what we'll be talking about. We'll go through them each one by one. So when I say a rewrite, I want to talk to you about what kind of a rewrite it was, whether it was just a small UI fix to it, what did we exactly change. So to begin with, it was a ground up rewrite. So nothing from the old app was used, none of the source code was used on the new app or anything. It was not only just the code which was not being reused, we changed the entire UI and the UX of the way the app behaves. So the app has been having the same set of UI and the UX from like 5 years now. This is the first time we have gone ahead and changed it, revamped it totally end to end. So just to give you an idea, even before I delve into the details, the new rewrite took us approximately about 3 lakh lines of code to get done on the existing, just to replicate the existing app out there today. The new app has 3 lakh lines of code. Took us 8 Android developers, around 10,000 cups of coffee, and like 6 months of time to get this done with. So that should give you an idea as to what kind of a rewrite it was. So today, before, by the end of this talk, what the aim is to give you an idea as to should you rewrite your app. Like, what does it do if you are in that boat, whether you are considering should I rewrite my app or should I just patch it up and let it work as it is working. So that is the objective of the talk today. I'll try to help you take that decision as to what is happening, what kind of effort is involved, so that you can make that decision whether do you need it. Do you need a rewrite? So we'll begin with looking at BookMyShow's motivations of rewriting first. Like, why did we choose to rewrite? So what happened was, a year ago, I was given that option to improve the performance of the existing app, or do I want to rewrite it? So I, of course, took the rewrite option because I always like to be latest. So a few bigger motivations we will look at as to what, why did we choose to rewrite. It is not just because I wanted latest. So I'll break them down as problems and challenges. These are problems and challenges that the old app had previously, which we wanted to overcome with the new rewrite. So the first thing which I would classify as a problem was spaghetti code. So if you don't know what that means, it is basically a bad paradigm in like a word which is used to indicate bad code in general. So there is nothing called as bad code. It is just that it lacks something like a naming convention. So if you see the examples at the right hand side, you can see there is no standard being followed. The variables namings is all over the place. There is underscore being used. There is a lowercase, uppercase. There is everything in lowercase. So not having a naming standard will hurt you in the longer run. Wherein a new developer comes to you, it is very hard to read this code. Like, if you give me this code, I would say I will not be able to understand what is happening here. Lack of reusability and modularity is again a big challenge that we had. So we have as an example, I'll give you a rating screen in the app which the app has. So you can rate a movie. There are multiple screens where you can rate the movie from. You can rate a movie via a push notification. You can go to the synopsis page of the particular movie and then rate it. you could even go to the ticket history and then rate it. So this is just an example. So this is like three places where you had it. The old app had the rate functionality being written at all the three places. Each activity had the logic being there. So while it should have been just in one single place, so that you know, okay, like rate as a functionality is one to the entire project. It should not make a difference where you are calling it from or where it is being used. The other thing which was a big major hurdle was tight coupling between the business logic and the UI. So if you can see this example, everything here is very use case specific. And if you see at the very top, like you see, you see GA, so Google Analytics code. So right from your analytics code to your view to your business logic of modifying, checking whether it is credit card, debit card, all of that was happening in one single screen. So tomorrow when you modify the screen, it is you risk two things. One is breaking existing functionality, and it is very hard to understand why, where, what is happening. So debugging also becomes a problem. The other bigger challenge which BookMyShow had was scalability. We, over the past years, few years, have been growing at a scale which we did not anticipate. Our users have, downloads have grown up and users use us drastically, but the app has not been able to keep up with the same. So, and adding a new feature was very hard. So in general, I'll talk a little about what scalability issues we had as well. A lot of it was redundant duplicate code. Again, I'll come to a simple example is, this is how the old app used to make a HTTP call. So every call, API call which you make would go ahead, create a new HTTP post, HTTP URL, add those params, do some basic checks, and then make the call. So what would happen is, for every API call, the same things would, half of the things would keep repeating, but they were just written everywhere. So a lot of duplicate code was being there. This kind of code is very hard to refactor. So as an example, let's look at that. You say, I give you, look at 1, 2, 3, 4th line there. It has a parameter called as a timeout, and it takes in a 30,000 millisecond kind of A. So let's assume you wanted to increase or decrease this timeout for all the API calls. With this kind of structure, what would happen is, every single class you would have to go and modify that 30,000 value, which is very bad if you, like, you know, have to touch 20 different files to make one small change. Ideally, this value should have been at one place, and that updating that value should just be changing it everywhere else. So it kind of started becoming hard to refactor. This cause started causing delay in our app release cycles as well, wherein our app updates started becoming slower. And of course, when you have code like that, you end up with a lot of regression bugs. Like, one developer tries to touch something on a particular screen, ends up breaking somebody else's feature on that screen altogether. So it becomes very cumbersome, and again, this also affects your development cycle in terms of everything that you touch on that screen has to go through a thorough QA process, and that takes time. Like, you have to get through QA, if there is something broken, fix. That cycle keeps on happening until you get there. So again, a lot of delays being introduced before, for a very small functionality also. Like, imagine adding just one line of code, and you end up saying, okay, I will take 4 days to test it, an hour to develop, but 4 days to test, which did not make sense at all. Like, it was becoming the bottleneck for the company. A/B tests. So what the company as a challenge wanted to do was try a few things based on A/B tests. So basically wanted people to look, half of the users go to a particular, see a particular view, and the other see a particular view, so that we could check our conversion ratios and all of those things as well. So that was very hard with the new old app to be done, because of the way it was structured. It became very hard to run an A/B test, and that was something which the company wanted from a long, long time. So let's look at what we did. These were some of the major challenges and problems and the motivations behind why BookMyShow was rewritten. Let's look at what did we change, why, how did we do it. The first thing that got changed was the architecture. So for over the past 2 years, you have kept hearing MVP, MVVM, so many of these have come up. Like, everybody keeps saying MVVM is great, MVP is great, it helps you do that, it helps you do this. So One thing I had always complained from the past 2 years was there was no example out there in the production in the wild saying ki, yes, I have used this in a production on a 10 million plus user base and it works the way it is saying. Everybody says it is nice, everybody gives demos, talks about it, but nobody did it in a real world. So we took it up as a challenge on ourselves. We wanted to run a very bleeding edge kind of tech stack for the new app. So we changed the architecture to MVP. Doesn't have to be MVP. Like I keep getting this question a lot of time, which architecture is the best according to you? I would say there is no silver bullet. It is based on what you are trying to do is that is more important. MVP suited BookMyShow does not necessarily mean ki it is the best or should suit you. It depends on your use case. So you, those who don't know what MVP is, just a quick glance on the right side. You break up your code into views, presenters, and models. Presenters are basically responsible for the views are basically responsible for the UI. Presenters and models being your business logic, and presenters being the interactor between both of those things. So we changed after the architecture. The big change was the user experience in general of the entire app, as I mentioned. I'll show you a few things. So now we have smart filters in the new app. So a lot of people, if you have been using the website, you already have used this feature on the on our website, wherein you could filter show times by time and price as well. You could tell, okay, show me all the shows, all evening shows within the price range of 100 to 200, and we would filter that. So that comes up with the new app. We have those filters now. Seat layout, something which was a most used screen in the entire app, which we have today. So what we noticed was a lot of people would go to the seat layout screen, then figure ki they did not find the best seats which they were trying to look for. So what they would have to do is go back, change the show time, change the category, and then come back again. That was a little frustrating, like, you know, how many times should you go back and what all could you check. So now the new app gives you a quick switch at the top itself. If you see, you can change the show time right away from here itself. This is a 8-5 p.m. show. You could just click on it and get the show times. You also can change the quantity as well. So previously it was very hard to change the quantity. You would have to go back, choose the show time again, and choose the quantity again. So now you do not need to do this. Everything happens in this single screen itself. The synopsis page went through a big redesign as well. We now show you very rich information about everything related to the movie, right from the runtime to the lead cast and a lot of things on the synopsis page. The other big change that happened was unit testing. So, as I said, the cycle of updates kept going higher and higher. It 1 hour of code, 4 days of testing did not work out. So we started off with that approach where we wanted to everything to be unit tested within the code itself and not rely on the manual QA, thus reducing the times. So this is just a sample test which we have, which basically tests a presenter as of this. This is a presenter test, I believe. So that is one thing. So this is why we did it. This is what we did. We chose to do a few things different from what you would have seen in the regular Android world. We'll quickly have a look at what they are. Packaging. So the general packaging has always been of the factor you club all your activities together, you club all your adapters together. So what ends up happening is if you have an application like BookMyShow at that scale, your activities package has like 300 lines of activity, 300 classes activities. You have 200 adapters, so it becomes huge, and like, you know, it is very hard with no standard naming convention. It becomes very hard which adapter is being which used where, which makes debugging harder. So what we went ahead and did was package things by features. So as a screenshot, if you see, everything related to summary page would be on the summary, inside the summary package. Everything related to the settings and the seat layout would rely in the respective packages. So tomorrow when you have a bug, that is how you get a bug, right? Somebody reports a bug to you, he says, on your seat layout, this does not work. So I exactly know which set of files to look at. It becomes very easy to debug because seat layout, I know there is a package named as seat layout. Anybody can debug it, not only the developer who has written it. just to give you an idea what the packages, internal packages look like, so let's look at coupons as a feature. Internally, we have coupons as a functionality has three sub features. You can add coupons, you have to get the coupons from the server, and you can remove the coupons which you have previously added. So they are sub packaged as well based on that. Standalone module. So Arun also spoke about this in his Gradle talk today morning, wherein break up your project into different things and add them as a dependency. That is exactly what we have ended up doing. So on the right hand side, if you see our network, our analytics, error, models, all of these are separate projects and repositories by themselves. So what happens is your motivations are two. One is it is easily refactorable. Today we use Retrofit as our networking library. Tomorrow if you want to use Wally for some reason, move away from Retrofit, it is very simple. The app does not need to change. Some team can independently work on the network module, fix, change, make those changes, give me a pre-compiled jar or a new versioned AR file, and I just include it. So that becomes dead simple in terms of integration, and your timelines become parallel. So previously what would happen is if you are trying to do Wally, you would either create a separate branch and then merge it and you would have conflicts, or you would wait until he finishes and then start on with the changes he has done. Today you don't need to do that because both of them can work parallelly without, since they are both two different projects altogether. So this is just an example of how we have broken up all our things into separate repositories. Just to give you a fair idea as to how we maintain, how do I know if with moving from Retrofit to Wally nothing breaks. So we try to follow the standard Java API kind of structure, wherein if a method is public and has been exposed in any version or a jar file which has gone out, the structure and the parameters, the return type, nothing ever changes. So if you see, my app always talks to network manager, does never talk to Retrofit directly. Network manager talks to Retrofit and gives me that thing. So I have created this abstract layer. If you see this, there's something called as get trending API. If you see, there is no mention of Retrofit within it, and the return type is of observable. So the app who is calling this only calls get trending API, does not need to know whether I'm using Retrofit or Wally for that matter. So you could easily switch tomorrow and nobody will even have a problem with it. Same thing with the analytics thing, just to give you a fair idea. We have a wrapper class on the analytics manager as well. Self-sufficient view. So this was a pretty interesting idea. I'll take the rating screen as an example again. As I said, it was being used in three different places in the entire app. You could write your code logic in one place, but the UI would still need to be included in three different places. We were still not happy with that. We decided, why can't both the UI and the logic stay at one place and everybody reuses it? So this is what we went ahead and did. So there is something called as a view provider, a abstracted layer which we have written on top of a manager kind of thing. The activity, whoever wants the view, right, asks the view provider to give me that view. What the view provider does is builds that view, returns the view, and you can just show it in your activity. Does not have to be declared in your XML predefined. So you could essentially put it in activity ABC as of today, and tomorrow if you want it in D, it would just be one line of code. Just to give you an example as well, this is what the code looks like. So we used view stub here in this case. You could return a regular view also, it would not make a difference. So if you see, this inflates the view. So does the find view by IDs, has the logic for everything inside it, sets the click listeners as well. So this is a self-sufficient view. It not only returns you the view, but the click listener on those views also are handled by that itself. So you say, give me a ratings view. The ratings view comes up. The ratings view has edit text. Now it has a submit button wherein it has to make an API call. So you as a developer do not need to know somebody has already worked on the ratings view. So you say, give me the ratings view. And when you click submit, you do not need to know what is happening, which API to hit, what to do. All you need to know is whatever the value is, the view will take care of it. So you do not need to bother at all. So these views are self-sufficient in that way, wherein the logic and the UI is both on them itself. So I in particular was not happy with the way Android developers write API request calls, params, the way you, too much of lowercase, uppercase, mismatch of cases happening, too many problems occurring. So what we decided was this, there has to be a better way of doing this. We wanted to be very user friendly, developer friendly more like, so that any new developer that comes in the company, it does not have to go through like 10, 20 different documentations just to understand what param is the key and what is the value type it is expecting. So we created something called as a param builder. These are nothing but simple plain old Java objects. So if you see, this is just an example. This is a plain Java class which has a ton of strings and defined in it. So these are key and values defined here. So what that lets me do is looks like something like this. So I say new API builder and I do a dot on it. Now since this is a separate project and is added as a dependency, I get autocomplete on it. So I, the moment you do new API builder dot, you see all the available APIs which you can make a request to. And once I choose the same API which we just saw and it do a dot again, you all see the set parameters available. So you do not need to know what the key are, what the URL is, what the type is. You don't, you as a developer do not need to bother, okay, like is this a post request, is this a get request, what are the keys that I am supposed to send to this, what are the session timeouts that I am supposed to send. So none of that is on the overhead. All you do is focus on the values which you need to be sent. So they are written in a way wherein they are human readable as well. So if you see set app version, OS version, so that you just understand just by reading at it, okay, this is what I have to send. And the dot build API parameters will set up everything and give you a custom object of the sort. So two things here, as I mentioned, improved readability, autocomplete. Just by looking at this piece of code, I can tell you what parameters it is expecting and what is not. I do not need to look at the documentation. Dimension naming. So we were again unhappy with the way Android developers name dimension files. It is always a fight between these two. You either take a very generic approach at the bottom, you define font dot font underscore large, font underscore small, or you take the very specific approach, give it the activity name underscore image underscore all of those things. So both have this their own set of problems. So the below one has this problem wherein if somebody is using font.small and tomorrow somebody changes that font.small from 12 dp to 14 dp, everybody who uses it breaks away. Whereas you might just want 12 dp there and 14 dp somewhere else. If you use a specific one, you, while that solves the problem, you end up with tons of duplicates. 16 dp has been declared like 20 times in your things because all of them are specific. What we did was embrace both of them. So if you can see at the top, we defined something called as dimen underscore 3 dp, 4 dp, 5 dp, 6 dp. At the bottom, there were specific namings. So in this example particular, you can see seat layout activity underscore text coupons available size, and that would then reference the dimension declared at the top. So now it avoid those duplicates. Every dimension is declared exactly once, and you still have that specificity so that you can debug quickly. Okay, this is the dimension which is being used. So you do not need to know what is happening. So I would want to talk to you about what were some of the learnings or the outcomes which we did. Like 6 months we have been working on this. So I mentioned using MVP as the architecture which we use for the new app. One thing which we realized over time is I would not call MVP an architecture. I would call it more of a design pattern. It is not really a full-fledged architecture. It is more of a design pattern. Use it if you know what you're trying to do. If you want clean code, this is one way of doing it. But it is not a full-fledged architecture kind of thing wherein how MVVM would work. So that has been one big learning. So you always can't skip anything about talking about without talking about multi-dex. So if you are using the latest stack, something like a retrofit, Dagger, and anything on those lines, RxJava, you would hit this limit very fairly soon. Like there is a blog post as well which says if you use Google Play services along with these four libraries, you will hit the 52k limit without even having one of your own methods. So out of those 64, 65K, 52K methods are gone away. So that becomes a problem. So of course your easiest solution is multidex. Go to your application class, multidex.install this. End of story. Multidex should work. Our experience has been different. So what happened was we started facing a lot of crashes on devices which are not up to the mark with Google standards. So Xiaomi phones, Redmi phones, what would happen is the app would just crash away. Like it did now. Okay, so one thing is that take care of it. One quick solution, if you are running into that same problem wherein it is crashing on such devices, is extend your application. Instead of extending your class application class by just extends application, extend multidex application. That solved a lot of crashes for us. I have no clue why though. The other thing which you need to look at when you enable multidex is the startup time. So one thing that has happened is the startup time has gone up on a device below API level 21 where multidex is not supported natively. The startup time on a cold start might increase by a few seconds. So that is something you should seriously consider whether you want to do it or not. Maintenance. So after all of this, the whole reason of doing this was maintenance. One thing I would say is it has been able. It has now become very easy to maintain a particular the app in general, so we do not any longer feel a problem when a change comes. Since the views, the presenters and everything has a single responsibility, I know what to change before and it does not break anything. Since you have unit tests, the unit tests automatically tell you before, even before you give it to the QA, that it is breaking, you need to fix it. So maintenance has become very simple, very easier to do. Maintaining the app is now very easy in general. The other thing is adding new features. So adding a new feature also has become fairly simple. As an example, our previous average time a new feature, basic feature would go live on by a developer, single developer, would be around 7 to 10 days worth of work. Today, after the new architecture, we are seeing the same feature when since we rebuilt the same feature on the old app and the new app as well. So on the new app, we are able to do it in like 2 days. So that is one big gain, like your development time will drastically, efficiency-wise, will improve. So that is something which you might be interested in. If you are looking to build a product on the longer run, wherein you have a lot of features planned and scalability and maintenance is your concern, then I would definitely suggest you to rewrite it in a particular fashion. It does not have to be MVP, as I said. You could use any MVVM, any of those, whatever suits you better. I like to call it MVW, M model view, whatever. So you can use whatever you want to do it with. It will just work the same, to be honest. So that has been pretty much what we have done. I'll just talk to you about what we plan to do in the coming months as well. Dynamic view rendering. So this has been on our list for a while now. So as you saw, I spoke about self-sufficient views. What we want to do is send some data, some sorts of JSON from the server and render those views on the fly without an app update. So imagine doing this wherein I have a recycler view with, I have a ratings view. So tomorrow on any screen the server sends you a particular key, all I need to do is just inflate that view there. So it does not make a difference any longer to us. So eventually what we would want to do is control view rendering altogether. We would want to be able to position items one below after, all from the server without an app update. One thing which I also forgot to mention is when you use an architecture like this, for that MVP, MVVM, your code base increases in size. What used to happen in one single Java class with one activity is now spread across five to six different classes. You have interfaces, you have use case controllers, you have their presenters. For each, just one single screen, you have six different things. So that takes time, like development time goes up there, writing 6 different screens in their respective packages, all of that takes time. So what we were able to do, we have a basic demo of this working, wherein we used annotation processors to generate all of this. So what would happen is, you could go to a terminal, right now it is a command line tool, you could just go to your terminal and tell him what you are trying to do. Give him key, this is the name of the screen, and I need this kind of a particular view. What it would do is two things. It would give you a view, let's say you say, give me a recycler view with this name. So what it would do is, it would set up an activity for you, it would set up an adapter for you, it would give you a recycler view in the XML, and would take care of writing the presenters and the domains all together. You just have to go there and put your business logic. All the boilerplate for you is generated. All of this happens at compile time using annotation processors. So that is something which we are very excited about. In the future, we would want to generate a lot of code like this, wherein I could just go to the terminal, say ki, in this project, I want a recycler view with so these features, and it generates the basic setup for me. I just have to implement the business logic out of it. So we would eventually want to move to a event-driven architecture. We used event buses in our current, in the new app as well. Specifically, we used auto. Our experience has been a mixed bag kind of thing, wherein it is very nice in decoupling everything. You don't have that hard binding, okay, I need to implement this interface on this activity. It takes care of it by on subscribe and push. But one big, there are a lot of problems which we face with event buses in general. So as a quick example, what I could do is, let's look at the show times. So you have a show times response model which is created, same plain old Java class which is created. Now, let's say the user went to the screen, he's shown a loader, the network is call is still going on, he went back and came back quickly. So what would happen is, if the response would come, since the model object is the same for both the API calls that happened. So I would, there would be no way for me to differentiate whether it was the first one or the second one that came through. So that becomes a little problematic in such edge cases. Everywhere we have to have a flag kind of thing, where did this user call something. So that has been a little big learning, wherein event buses have been a little backfiring to us, to be honest. That should be it. I should be open to taking questions. I have 12 minutes.
Hi. Yeah. Thank you for the talk. Is this new app was like parallelly getting built, like meanwhile the old app is there, or like how was the development process?
So we, in BookMyShow specifically, what we did was, we had a 4-member team, Android specifically, I'll talk Android specifically, 4-member team existing who was maintaining the old app. We did not touch those resources, we hired, built a parallel team of 8 members, and they built it within the 6 months. So both of them were working parallelly for the past 6 months. Currently this new app is in a staged rollout phase, wherein it has been rolled out to 20% of our user base. By the end of this month, it should be on 100 and everybody should have it.
But then how did you handle like the code duplication, like a feature being developed on the other one, and then you probably have to port the code on the new one because you need to write like everything from 100%?
Correct. So what good question. Like, you know, what happened was, there were a few features which the old app could not wait for. Like, we could not push those features away. So what we ended up doing was, of course, we had to write the old app team wrote the feature on the old app, and while the new app team did it on the new app. Because the architectures were way too different to reuse anything, to be honest.
So we had similar issues while dealing with auto, while building an event-driven architecture and using like a view page or something.
Okay.
And ridiculous number of flags and publishers and subscribers to just figure out where the event is going.
Correct.
When you go out of the app and come back in. So how did you fix your event-driven architecture? Because one day we woke up and they have put up on the GitHub page saying we have deprecated it, please use RxJava. So we're like, you know what, we'll just delete it from our app. We are not going to use it anymore. So how did you deal with this?
So there were multiple solutions which we came up with. One was, you could modify the, if you are talking about the same screen thing, right? on the same screen, if you are getting, he goes back and comes back again, and the call gets two times, and you get two responses of the same type. What we one simple solution was having a flag enabled, whether I have called this API already in the past or not. That would tell me whether, okay, have we already called this, and there is the response coming supposed to be something else. So what we ended up doing, like that was a quick hack to do it. What we actually ended up doing was we use RX Java and observables to for our networking tied with retrofit. Whenever the user went away and we did not need that information, I would cancel that API call altogether or unsubscribe. So you could either cancel that API call, the first one, or you could just unsubscribe the current subscriber.
So we are doing the same then. Auto was a very bad decision.
To be honest, like in the coming future, I would get rid of auto and use fallback to interfaces.
Thank you.
During your code, so at one place you had that DP problem and you assigned variables to all the DP sizes. Right?
Correct.
So I mean, we followed. I was working in Monster and we followed the same practice for colors. And I mean, I was doing that and I was wondering why am I doing that? I mean, even though I implemented, you know, our manager and everyone told us to do that, but I found it to be a very bad practice because in the end, all color like color. 93FF, you know, the whole hash code, hex code, and mapped to the color itself. And they were about like 100, 200 colors. Same thing you did for a DP thing, I'm guessing.
Correct.
So, but I mean, I think there's no point behind it. What would be the use case of, I mean, what could be a possible reasoning for you to do that?
So, it is debugging becomes easier. So, what happens is when you have a huge layout, and let's say you have like 14 different colors in that, and you have no clue which color is binding from where. Okay. Now, when you want to debug, what would happen is you would have to click, go to that, then realize, okay, this is not the color I'm looking for. Go back. This is not the text view color which I'm trying to change. So, what would now, if you look at my slide, what this would do is with such specific naming conventions like seat layout, activity, image, coupon, tag height, I exactly know what view I am talking about on the UI. So we try to map it, how it looks on the screen in our XML as well. Correct. Correct. So you are saying like I could have just written 6DP here, correct? So we did that. We started off there. Okay. The problem was 10 different developers, 10 different screens, everybody wanted a 8DP. Everybody would define 8DP, 8DP, 8DP. We had 10 8DPs, so duplicates. So that is one way of handling it where when we wanted to be unique.
Hi. On what basis did you choose 20% of users to enable new application?
So that was a staged rollout. We started off with 5%. As of now, it is at 20%. So it is a Play Store staged rollout. We do not choose the users.
Okay. And how do you see the difference between old app and new app?
Pardon?
How do you see the difference between old app and new app?
Very drastic difference is, one thing is development is easier. Today, we are able to do things which we had never imagined we would be able to on the old app. One example is deep linking. What we ended up creating was one single class which deep links everywhere. So today, you could give me any BookMyShow HTML link, and I would be able to deep link it to a particular section in the app. And it is very smart enough to figure out fallbacks. So let's say it will be smart enough to figure out, okay, you tried to open this page, but you did not have a particular value which was needed to render that page. What it would do is it would make an API call, get that value, and then render that page as well, if that is a possible use case.
And how did you find out the areas that UX is needed improvements?
So most of it is user feedback. Since the website went live, a lot of people have been asking us for price and this filters on the app for a long, long time. So majority of our UX changes have been driven by users' feedback, to be honest.
So I have two questions.
Yeah.
One is that, are you going to make a few things that you think can be open sourced, like these auto-generated code and dynamic view rendering, so things like those?
So we have spoken about it. We might not open source the entire thing, but we might just put up a demo sample which gives you how we did it. So just to answer your question, that auto-generated code, right? Look up something called as annotation processors. Just try to figure out to match your use case. It has nothing. Look, just so if you have used butter knife in the past, if you have used dagger, any sort of annotation, like if you have used Android, you know annotations @override. That is what tells Android, okay, you are trying to do something. So we use the same concept wherein we have @generate, @generate make presenter. What that would do is you will need to just compile it once, and when you run it, it would automatically generate a set of classes in the folder. Hopefully I will at least put up a sample project which you can look at.
And my other question is, like, how do you deal with DB schema updates? So do you use a NoSQL kind of thing, or do you use SQLite, or how do you work?
So the old app used SQLite, the new app uses RHEL. So there is nothing much of a difference apart from the speed and the performance, to be honest. It still has the same problems from migrating from the older to the newer version.
So you write like multiple schema changes, codes again and again, like for...
If we have to. So one thing which we have learned is writing for scale involves a few thinking changes as well. The way you think about it is more important. So today, whenever I request the server side things to send me a key, a response, a value kind of thing, I usually ask them to give it to me in a JSON array instead of a JSON object. So let's say tomorrow, ads, we are doing native ads within the content. So within the movie list, you see a third card being as an ad. So that ad would come through. But what would happen is, okay, today you wanted to do one ad, tomorrow you say two ads. Now your JSON structure changes. You can't break the older API, but you want to have the new one. So what we end up doing is we created JSON arrays. So JSON arrays with one element as of now. So tomorrow, if you want to scale, you could keep just adding whatever you want to. That is one thing. On the client side of things is, we try to make it, as I said, I try to maintain a very public kind of facing interface from all those other projects. So what we do is we usually take in a hash map as a parameter. Okay. So what hash map lets me do is add multiple params over time without breaking the constructor. So if your constructor is not changing, you do not have to bother. And of course, we use dagger for dependency injection as well. So everything is injected rather than being created. So testing becomes easier. So hash map has been a great thing, but hash map again comes at a cost. Memory is on the higher end for a hash map compared to a comma separated string comma constructor. So we try as much as possible to keep the hash map structure followed because it works for us, because our requirements keep changing that much.
Hello. Let's say we are using certain library for now.
Okay.
So we have a non-standard phone and that library doesn't work. So how do you are going to handle it?
So never actually came across something. We do not support non-Google Play services, nothing in China. Everything has been in India for us. So honestly, that does not. We have not really thought about something like that. Can you give me an example if something has happened to you? Maybe I can then relate. Like, why would a library work on X and not on Y? Because at the end of the day, it's just Java, right? So you use RxJava is still Java at the end of the day. It's not something else.
Just a simple thought that if you are using an image library,
yeah.
So sometimes it might work, sometimes it may not work. I just thought of it. Mm. I really didn't come out across that such cases.
Okay. Not really, to be honest. We have never faced something like that. Yes, we do.
Hi.
Hi. You said you developed a view provider for reusing some components, like not only views, the functionality is attached to those views also.
Yeah.
So why didn't you go for fragments, for developing fragments, instead of creating new view provider? And
so
fragments can provide the same functionality, I guess.
Correct. But so fragment, we have two problems, life cycles being attached, which I do not want to be responsible for. I, let's say, just want to show a dialogue on a screen. I would not want to use a fragment. And if you are using a fragment, you need to know the position of the fragment beforehand in your XML.
So So that can be handled.
You can, to be honest. But we chose views were simpler. So if you see, the Synopsys page had a small strip of lead cast, right? So that has been written as a separate view and functionality together. So tomorrow, if you could give me an event, a movie code, I could randomly show that view in any screen of the activity without anything.
Okay.
But again, the fragment should work as well.
Yeah. Hi. Just want to ask, like, there are two questions from my side. One,
yeah.
Like, why do you choose MVVM over MVP? Like, what specific problem you are not able to solve by using MVP?
So MVP also, what we chose, right, is been heavily customized. So MVP clearly says your context, Android, and all of those things needs to be there. We have customized MVP also to match our requirements. And one thing we have learned over time is there are always exceptions. So if you look at the seat layout screen which we have, there is too much of interaction happening. A typical MVP implementation would mean your activity and the presenter would need to communicate via the click would go to the presenter would then call something on the view. So that was too much of happening. So seat layout is the only exception in the entire app wherein we have everything in a single activity again. So MVP we chose over MVVM because MVVM we did not want to be doing view models and we had no interest in data binding anytime sooner. So MVP seemed like a more possible solution because we wanted to unit test our presenters independently as well. So all our presenters, ideally in an Android MVP project, the presenter can contain context, application, Android related things. But we have made it a point our presenters also do not have anything Android related. So the only thing that is Android related is RX, Android schedulers.mainthread, which obviously can be switched with a test subscriber.
Okay, so like you are saying, like you are preferring MVP at the end of the day.
We are because it fits our use case better.
Okay, and like, but you said like you are using some of the properties of MVVM as well.
So we not only use some properties from MVVM. We have looked at Viper, which is an equivalent of MVP in iOS. Okay, so we really like the router VIPER. R is the router part of it. So we modeled our navigation and everything on the router side of things. So I have a class called as router.java, which is one single place. Anybody who wants to navigate anywhere in the app has to go through that screen. So that happens wherein, like, you know, you get a push notification, that screen comes, he processes everything, and he knows which screen to redirect you to. Or if that screen is not available at a particular point of time, maybe like a new feature was added in a newer version of the app versus older version pe wo nahi tha. So what it would do is it would gracefully fall back if it is a web view, either open a web view or give a error to the user.
I think we can do that simply in MVP as well by using RX, like by using subscribe or unsubscribe. I think we can do that.
You can. I'm not saying you can't. I'm just giving an example as to what we have been trying to do.
Okay.
It's not just looking at MVP or MVVM or something else. It is trying to pick up things which are good in across OSs as well.
Thank you.
If you had to estimate the time it would have taken you to refactor the app, what do you think it would have been?
Pardon?
If you had to refactor the app, how long would have it taken you?
The new app?
The old one.
So I gave you a timeline.
No, you started from scratch, right? It took you 6 months starting from scratch. If you had to refactor the old app into the new one?
Difficult, to be honest. I would give it into the new one as in what terms? Like, do you
just
want
the
architecture
days,
to...
Just the number of days you think it could have taken you. Like, when you were deciding to refactor or rewrite the estimates.
It would have taken me approximately the same time, to be honest.
Okay.
Based on the tight coupling, right? Every screen I had to do that. So, that makes it...
Okay. Also, I didn't quite understand the dimensions thing you've done here, because you still have the dimensions underscore 28 repeated as many times as you would have if you just
simply
replaced it.
Yeah, but that is just a reference to it, right?
Okay.
And it is declared at once. So it is not, I'm not defining 2DP like two different times. It is just referencing to the exact same thing.
But they still have a one-to-one mapping, right? Like with dimension underscore 28, wherever you would have had 28, still
correct,
has a one-to-one mapping.
Correct.
So isn't it just boilerplate?
It is, but much more readable. It depends on your use case, again, as I said. Like we prefer because scalability and maintenance was a bigger concern, to be honest.
Thanks, Adnan.
Thank you.